Welcome to the Susquehanna Valley Baptist Pulpit, preaching a life worth living, abundant life in Christ. And now the message.
Well, we're in Ephesians chapter 5 this morning, Ephesians chapter number 5. And I want to draw your attention to our text this morning, for it has been this chapter our theme for the last many weeks. The scripture states there so quickly, "Wherefore," verse number 17, "be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is." This morning, I want to speak to you a little bit on this theme, comprehending the light. In fact, the question that I have for you this morning that will get our minds going and considering this is simply this: what is it that God wants you to do? If you can answer that question, and you can answer that question truthfully, and the only way to answer it truthfully is if it's reflected from the truths of the Word of God, you'll be able to have an understanding of something that many people in this world just have no true understanding about. What is God's will for your life? In fact, does God actually care about you? I mean, there's a lot of tragedies in the world. This is true. There's a lot of difficulties that are in the world. This is true. We were driving across state yesterday, and I look, and, you know, there's a few people mowing their lawns right now in our area. But even with the lack of rain that we've had, if you look on a global scale, there's people that have a lack of food. Life is not a fair place. Not everything works according to your dreams and ambitions that you might have. So how do you know that God even cares for you? That would really be the presupposition to it. To say, in fact, that God has a will for your life, you have to back that up and say, does God even care about you? The answer to that is clearly known in Scripture. A passage we should often surround around our mind is 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. "Casting all your care upon Him." Why? He careth. That ETH ending tells you that it is a continual state. There'll never be a time in this life as a child of God where God ceased to care for you. Now, if we were to go back to Matthew chapter 6, on His Sermon on the Mountain, God articulates through Jesus Christ, God articulates quite a level of care that He has. His care for you is married together with His ability. Now, your spouse may love you. I hope they do. In fact, more than love you, I hope they like you. But they can never care for you like God. Why? Because they do not have the character and attributes that an almighty God does. They can't read your mind. I know, they tell you when you get older, you've been married long enough, your spouse can almost read your mind. They can't see your heart. They can't always discern the motives behind what is done. Instead, they're imperfect people. On their best day, they're imperfect. There's going to be times where they said something that they did not really mean. And hopefully there's times where they meant something that they did not say. They are not God. And woe unto the couples who see each other as being so supreme and important in life that God has taken a back seat. God must be preeminent. God is truth. God is perfect. God is holy. God created you in His image, created He them, male and female, and He said of that creation that it is good. And God that knows all, the God that cannot lie, Titus 1, He knows all, 139th Psalm. He's ever present, 139th Psalm. He said He cares for His saints. That He's aware of the one bird that falls from the sky. How much greater are you? That as a father giveth good gifts, your Father in heaven giveth good gifts to you. There's no variableness nor shadow of turning, James chapter 1 and verse 17, in Him. So does God care for you? Yes. How much does He care for you? Look at Romans 5. Just hold your place here. Look at Romans 5. God cares for you so much, He is prepared for your greatest need. Now, what is the greatest need that humanity might have? Well, if you ask somebody that lives on Wall Street, the greatest need humanity has is money. That's the greatest need. If you ask somebody that lives in Hollywood, perhaps, what's man's greatest need? They might would say, well, it's entertainment. They got to get away. There's too many tough things in life, and just a couple of hours, that's man's greatest need. You'd ask someone that was at University Center Hospital System, in the finest science lab, what is man's greatest need? Well, he needs medicine. He needs availability to scientific equipment and medical equipment that can help him. I'm curious in my mind. I'm so curious. I'm a geek inwardly. I love to read and be familiar with some of the computer stuff. I'm very curious about this artificial intelligence, the opportunities that you and I might see in our lifetime as it pertains. Personally, I've related this to you before. I'm very curious about automated cars. I don't really care about driving. So if you can get a car where I can just ride, I'm happy. That seems to me to be a great thing. You think of how it overlays with the scientific needs that the world would have. It could really have some great opportunities, but that's not scientific advancement. That's not man's greatest need. In Romans chapter 5, look here. Romans chapter 5, draw your eyes down to verse 6. This is man's greatest need. For when we were yet without strength. So when was that? When was it that was without strength? Yesterday, the men, several of us, about 15 of us, we went down to Fort Ligonier, down towards Route 30, down a ways, near about 50 miles from Pittsburgh. And they've reconstructed this fort, and I'm always amazed. You go into the museum, and they've got these uniforms. Gettysburg's got them too. We were talking about them. I'm just always amazed. How did these genuine articles of clothing, they hung on the body of someone? And yet these military men were far slighter individuals, shorter, thinner. How did they do some of the muscular things they did? They hauled brass cannons over two mountains. I know they had horses, but come on. That's hard work. When was it that we were without strength? Is he saying when I was unborn? Is he saying when I'm old and now become feeble? No, that's the existence of every individual. The idea of without strength, that means I was helpless. And then he says, in due season, God died for the ungodly. That's the same as the helpless individual. Notice verse 8. I'm showing you man's greatest need. But God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners. That's your need there. That's when you were helpless. That's when you were without strength. In that time, before you came to the knowledge of the true God, before John chapter 3, Nicodemus speaking to the Lord at night, verse number 7, the Lord says, Nicodemus, ye must be born again. And old Saint Nick there had a peculiar understanding of what that meant. Verse number 8, how can a man be born when he is old? And he asked a stupid question. Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Can he reverse the birthing process? You know what the Lord responded to that question with? Art thou a master of Israel and knoweth not these things? In the next verse, he talks about the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, and canst not turn from whence it cometh, whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Whether that was a bit of sarcasm Nicodemus was engaging in, or whether that was just a little bit of real naivety on his part, Nicodemus, a master of religion in the nation of the people of Israel, had the same problem that all humanity has. He needed to be born again. And Peter, the old son of a fisherman, would say that we're born again, not of corruptible seed. That's how I'm physically born. I was born of a corruptible seed. From conception forward, I had one objective that I had to do in life, and that is that I would come to a point in life and will come to a point in life in which I must die. That's the result of everyone that is born of a corruptible, or that, in that essence, of a human seed. That's what's going to happen to all humanity. And Peter says we were born again, not of a corruptible seed, but of an incorruptible seed which liveth and abideth forever. God cares for you. Why? How much? Because He has cared for your greatest need ever. And that is of your eternal destiny. Note in Ephesians, because this is where our text takes us this morning. And I want you to draw your attention before we get down to our text. I want you to draw your attention to chapter number two. And we've touched base on this in the past week. When you're looking at the book of Ephesians, you really should look at it as a whole. We're taking our time and plowing through a little bit of Ephesians chapter 5. And so the context of Ephesians chapter 5 is dealing with believers, those who have received the marvelous gift of Jesus Christ. Not of works, chapter 2 and verse 8, 9 and 10, lest any man should boast. But we are, verse 10, His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus according to good works. Now notice, if you will, in chapter 2 and verse number 1. And you, believers, He hath quickened. He has made you alive, who were what? Dead. Pretty helpless and without strength, weren't you? You were dead in your trespasses and sin. When in time past you walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation. This is interesting. You'll hear sometimes folks talk about they've been a Christian all their life. Well, if you've been a Christian all your life, I don't know how you reconcile that with verse number 3. We all had our conversation in times past. Every individual had a time past in their life, every saint of God, a time past in their life where they were directed in a godless state. Now, I realize that you might be saying, when you said you've been a Christian all your life, you might really be saying that you were reared in a Christian environment all your life. And that's a completely different matter. There are several here that can say that. Mom and dad maybe got saved. That's the way it was for my parents. They came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ when I was 6 months from being born. And the decisions they made on that night to receive Jesus Christ had a lot to do with preserving me from many a sin and addiction in life. That's what it did. They literally served a preserving part in my life. And I must always be thankful for that. But them coming to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ in no way played a part in somehow saving me. Because individually, and that's how God deals with you on an individual basis. Every individual must come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Every individual must, by faith, call on the name of the Lord to be saved. And I did this individually. And my wife has done this individually. We have a marriage. As we go forth, our children, the same individual responsibility there can have. As a parent, I try to shield the wickedness of this world. And it seems with each passing week, year, and month, it grows and grows and grows and grows. I try to keep their hearts ready for the gospel of Jesus Christ. You want to instruct in biblical morality and truth. My friend, there's no way I can make my child or children come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. They are dead. They must be quickened, and can only be quickened by the God that can meet their greatest need. So back in Ephesians chapter 5, notice our word again this morning. Wherefore be ye not unwise, i.e. foolish, behaving like someone that has themselves as the God of their own heart, but understanding. And understanding is keenly linked with discernment, understanding what the will of the Lord is. So that brings us to this thought. What is God's will for His children? What does He want you to do. And some would take the idea that the will of God is a nebulous, that nobody can truly understand what it is. I don't think that's true. I think when you look in scriptures, there's a lot of ways in which you can see the will of God. For instance, you can see the will of God in a decretive manner. You go to Genesis chapter 1, God wanted light, so what did he do? Let there be light, and what happened? There was light. You can see it that way. You can see his will in a sovereign sense. The meticulous timeline that courses through the narrative of scriptures that bring about the ultimate desires of God's will. We have spoke just a moment ago on the individual will. The first thing God wants every individual to do is to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's what he wants you to do. You can fulfill none of the portions of the will of God without this matter of coming to him in faith. I think as we look in text, it's important to realize that the will of God is imperative for the Christian life. Harken back to verse 16, because of the days we live in. Our days are short. To not be able to understand what God wants from me is a terribly foolish lack of understanding on my part, because I have fewer years and days ahead with each passing day. What a terrible travesty that I would spend my life and say that I love a God that has saved me and have no comprehension at all of what God wants me to do in this life. The first step for every individual is salvation. Notice, if you will, in this second one, notice, if you will, verse 18. What is the will of God? And be not drunk with wine, where is excess, but be filled with the Spirit of God. I find it very interesting, the passage here. Be not drunk with wine. Oinos there. How does that relate to my walk with God? You know, a lot of folks will use this as something of a proof text. Say, well, the sin, as it relates to alcohol, is just not being drunk with it. I find it marvelous how many times in Scripture God associates certain sins together. Notice in chapter 5 in the first part there. Where is it? Look in verse 3. In fact, these are the sins he's going to mention in the 33 verses. If you want to know something specifically pointed to, he's going to talk about, you know, in its association in one sense, he's going to talk about fornication in verse number 3, porneia. This is the idea of sexual sins, specifically those embraced outside the bond of marriage, but not exclusively to. He's going to mention the sins of uncleanliness. That's general impurities, especially those with the opposite sex. Then he's going to come down to verse number 3, and he's going to talk about covetousness. And we know that as being aligned with greediness. We know that as being aligned with idolatry, Colossians chapter number 4. And then we come down here, and he just seems randomly to stick in drunkenness. I find that to be interesting. Why? Why did he pick that? All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable. Why that? I mean, why couldn't he just say theft? Why couldn't he have said cheating? Why drunkenness? And as you look throughout the scriptures, God has written so much in us, in the Word of God, as it relates to you and I. But he often places this particular sin in confines with other matters of wickedness. Let me show you one. Hold your place here in Ephesians and go over to Galatians. Now in Galatians chapter 5 and 22 and 23, you have the fruit of the Spirit. But in the preceding verses, 19, 20, and 21, you have the works of the flesh. Let's look at those. The works of the flesh, that's commonly attributed to the deeds of man. Now the works of the flesh are manifest. This is what man will just innately engage himself in. Ephesians chapter 2, according to the prince, the power that now worketh, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the mind, the lust of the heart. Ephesians chapter 2, 1 through 4. Now note these. The first on this list is adultery. You know what a common thing is? The common thing is not to have a fidelis marriage. That's what he's mentioning here. So when it comes to a matter of adultery, no God-fearing believer could say, I was walking in the Spirit when I committed adultery. Doesn't work. He said, I hate this. Fornication, same word in Ephesians. In one sense, that's that general sins of sexual nature of the flesh. And then he's going to come down to uncleanliness. He's going to mention lasciviousness again. Verse number 20, idolatry. Witchcraft. The witchcraft there, the Greek word is pharmaceutica, from which we get the word pharmacy. You think of the sorcery that exists in the book of Acts, same word, pharmaceutica, is often in so much demonic behavior, is the imbibing and addiction and focus on drugs. Someone told me this week, said, Preacher, you know what the great problem in our age is? And in my heart, I was like, I'm about to be told. Fentanyl. This world's got a fentanyl problem. Well, they're not wrong. He goes on to tell me how many individuals that sell drugs are taking and they're lacing marijuana with fentanyl. And young folks pursuing marijuana are taking this and they're smoking that marijuana. And as a result, it is lacing their bodies with fentanyl and it's creating an addiction and it's ruinous. And I thought, my, that's interesting. But then I thought about the congressional folks. Just a few years ago, both parties or all the parties, but every candidate was talking about opioid addiction. And every manner of evil. You want to see a mark of demonic oppression in our society? Follow the drug war. It's present. And you mark this, it's likely going to come to a place in our society that society will realize they can't fight it, so they might as well tax it. And that's where we're moving in our society. That is a work of the flesh. God's not anywhere near that. Notice, if you will, he mentions another one. Hatred. Variance. Emulations. Emulations are jealousy. Particularly the idea there is like a husband who caught someone with his wife. It's a burning jealousy. He's going to mention envying. It's almost like spite. Murders. Look at that word. I'm going to be honest with you. When I look at this, this is kind of ironic in my mind because people would tell you that drunkenness, you're just sinning against yourself. I mean, I didn't do anything to anybody else. That I can see that with hatred. I can see that with witchcraft. I can see that in a sense with adultery and fornication. But really, drunkenness? Revelings? That's carousing. Peter calls it banquetings. And then notice how he concludes in verse 21. Of the which I tell you before, as I has also told you in the past, that they which do such things, their life is defined by these. What's the scripture say? That's potent. Shall not. There's no maybe, if, ands, or buts. Someone whose life is chronicled by these is not one that is led or convicted by the Spirit of God in their life. Ergo, they do not have Christ. That's what he's saying. That is extremely strong language. And time will not allow us to go into other languages of this, but we only need to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and we find verbatim almost the same list. And yes, drunkenness is on that list too. Go back to Ephesians chapter 5. Why then is drunkenness in our age today? I read an article recently and it said the average Christian today, there is a growing number of them that when they look at scriptures, that they identify and say that really it's drunkenness the sin, but the process that brings about drunkenness is not the sin. The word wine In the Old Testament, it's mentioned 141 times. And I would note something very important. A lot of times people have really poor hermeneutics when it comes to interpreting the Scriptures. And what they'll look at is they'll look at some places in Scriptures where wine is used. For instance, John chapter 2, God created water out of wine. And they'll look at that and say, right there, God created that, therefore God's not against it, therefore I can just do what I want to do. They're reading a lot of their culture into it. You know, I realize that in the historic days of past, there was not the distillation process that we have. In fact, one article I read recently when it spoke of wine in the Old Testament, for instance, in Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 1, wine is a mocker and strong drink is raging, and who thereever deceived thereby is not wise. They said if you take that strong wine, it's about the strongest they could make it. You know what it was equivalent to? An average beer. That was the alcoholic level that they had. But there'll be many that take it and say, well, you know what that means? I can drink and it's okay. I just can't get drunk. And they'll go out and get some hard liquor and say, look, Jesus created water and wine. That's okay for me to drink hard liquor. I mean, they have read in what is available today was not. There was no refrigeration process. There's no distillation process. There's no pasteurization process. None of that existed. And so many will look at this and this idea of drunkenness is the sin, not the actual drinking. You know, there's a lot to be said with that that time won't allow me, but let me give you three passages. In fact, look over in Proverbs. I cited this one already. Look at Proverbs chapter 20. I just cited this one a moment ago. Proverbs is a place of general wisdom. And so if I look at general wisdom, it should give me a course on which I am to plot in my life. Now the reality is, and there's a lot of techniques and nuances in this, that the strongest alcoholic beverage that they had during the time of Christ was not nearly as strong as what is available today. It's also plausible that the wine that they crushed fermented quickly and therefore to their best efforts either became vinegar or had some type of fermentation to it. The way around that they would take is they would boil it down to where it was like a honey consistency, and that's what they would store. If you'll think about it, they really only had water, some very few other drinks, some milk, and this type of fruit with no way to refrigerate it. So they would take this honey-like consistency, and they'd squeeze it and mix it up to a ratio of 20 to 1. It's estimated that you would have had to drink gallons and gallons and gallons of that stuff to be physically moved like contemporary alcohol does today. It's not the same thing. But in keeping, look at the wisdom of the Proverbs. Look at Proverbs chapter 20. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not, what's the word? But be ye not unwise. Know ye what the will of the Lord is. Look in Proverbs 23. Drop your eyes down to the back part of that verse, the back part of the chapter. Verse 29. Who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babblings, words that you can't understand? Who hath wounds without a cause? Who hath redness of eyes? Verse 30. Interesting how it starts off, those that tarry long at wine. I met a lady, she's passed on now. And in conversation with her, she went on a tirade, I think we would call it, about how she hated alcohol. And I was a bit perplexed because I knew a number of her friends did not have her same feeling about it. Now, I knew hers was not a biblical persuasion. And I asked her, why do you feel that way? She said, well, don't you? And I said, but that's aside from what, why do you feel that way? Without batting an eye, that woman looked at me, straightened her 77-year-old body up. She said, because my dad was a drunkard. I'd only known her to be a pleasant lady, but the way she said that, it invoked all of the harshest memories possible. I was a bit taken back. She began to go in on the poverty, the injury, the abuse. And yet there'll be many Christians today. I tell you, there's Christians today that go around pronouncing the somehow legitimacy of social drinking, never spent time in a drunkard's home. They spent time in the home of some godly parent that may not have been consistent in all their actions of life. And they've looked in this newfound liberty they may have, and they say, it's what I'm going to do. It's okay. I can control myself. And that's the beginning that every drunk thinks to. They can control himself. Drunkenness has ruined homes and lives and minds and testimony. Listen, you want to know the first time the Hebrew word for wine, yayin, first time it's mentioned. You know what it's referencing? Noah. And he got drunk. About the second or third time you find it, it's Lot. And Lot got drunk. And the irony is, both of these individuals are righteous men, and one day I will see them in heaven. How could they have avoided this? I don't want to leave my flesh up to self-control with something that can be so detrimental. We don't accept this in life. There's not a sobering parent, no pun intended there, there's not a sobering parent here that would look and tell your 16-year-old child just got the driver's license, now I really think you ought to take my brand new Mustang, get on 283 the freeway, and just go as fast as you can. You'll really enjoy it. Just be careful. Who's going to do that? There's no sober-minded parent ever going to tell them to do that. That's dangerous and foolish. Yet there are many Christians with immorality and booze that will take that same mindset. At best, it's foolish. And I think not that there's any best about it. Notice he says, verse 31, you want to know how to escape it all? Young man, young woman, verse 31, look not on the wine when it is red, when it giveth its color in the cup, when it moveth. You know what he's talking about? Don't even put your eyes on it. That fermentation process, let it go. Why? At the last, it biteth like a serpent, stingeth like an adder. What's the results? Well, verse 33, thine eyes shall behold strange women. Recently, there was a young lady, she won a civil case over in California, and it was about assault, sexual assault. The first time there was a hung jury, so it got dismissed, so it came back a second time. And I was curious, how does this happen? It was the same guy, it's the same woman, there's the same facts. The first time it didn't go through, you just do this, keep doing, how does this work? So I began to read some of her testimony that was available publicly, and it started with her drinking in his bed. Now, wisdom does not seem to be something in the center of that. And oh, how many times it was just an innocent drink. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. You ever notice the drinking of alcohol never makes one more intelligent? I have a vice. I like a good old Western. I really do. But inevitably, there's this gunslinger, and he's the fastest guy in the West. And there's this other guy. I don't know who he is, but there's always this guy, and he's got to face off against this gunslinger. And you know what he always does? They go get some liquid courage. Now, they don't get drunk, because then they won't be able to draw. But they go get a little liquid courage, and they're going to go out there. And at the end of the day, the gunslinger always wins. I don't know if that's subliminal messaging or not. Thine eyes shall behold things. Thine heart shall utter perverse sayings. You know what he's talking about? You tear at that wine, you'll lose your personal moral filter. You'll say things you never would have said. That's how you have contentions without a cause. You go to a bar, don't be surprised when they fight. Why? People lose their filter. They don't mean to say what they said, but they said it. And you didn't mean to respond to what they said, but you heard it. And it can't be taken back. They say, go to fisticuffs over it. He goes on in verse 34. Yea, thou shalt be at him that lieth down in the midst of the sea. I've never been in the midst of a sea, but I've been on a boat in some pretty deep water, and wind came along and you just rocked back. You have no equilibrium. You watch what a fellow drinking does. There's a reason why this time of year, and it'll specifically be out in about 2 or 3 weeks, about buzz driving, drunk driving. They'll say in verse 35, they have stricken me. Thou shalt say, I was not sick. They have beaten me. I have felt it not. When shall I awake? What will happen? Now listen, there's a number of reasons here on why not to even be involved with alcohol at all. But verse 35 is pretty potent. Especially that concluding phrase, it's addictive in nature. I will seek it yet again. I was down in Washington, D.C., and something happened to me 3 times in a period of about a day. I had an individual come up to me, and they looked like somebody had beat the living tar out of them. Teeth missing, cuts and scrapes on their body, fouled, smelling, asking me if I had a dollar or two. I assumed there could be a number of reasons they needed it. And this one fellow came, I declined, and he went over to where there was some food, and the guy gave him a piece of, like, pizza or something. You know what he did? He turned it down. Why? Whatever his fix was had a hold on him in this life. You know, in my life, I can count on one hand how many good-looking, attentive, I'm not talking savers, save folks, just good-looking, got most of the teeth. I know hockey players being an exception, but got most of the teeth, smell okay, smiling, have walked up and asked me for a dollar bill. That has happened to me so very rarely in life. But it's amazing how often alcohol and narcotics are involved in it. Let me show you one other passage. You're in Proverbs, Proverbs Book of Wisdom. Look in chapter 31. Solomon writing, let the words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother taught him. Now we often think of the 31st chapter as it relates to the virtuous woman, and it does. But I want you to hear these early words she told him. What? You almost hear a cry, her maternal cry. What, my son, the son of my womb? What, the son of my vows? Give not thy strength unto. She's telling him to be monogamous. Nor that ways to things, or nor that ways to which destroyeth kings. It is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine. Nor for princes strong drink. Notice verse 5. Why, mama? Well, honey, let me tell you, I've seen a thing or two. Lest they drink and they forget the law, and pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted. Verse 6. Give strong drink of him that is ready to perish. Wine of him that is of heavy heart. Not for thee, O Lemuel. Why the analogy, though? It seems here it's more than just a matter of drunkenness and to drink or not to drink or how much to drink, and all of that can be spoken about. But what is it God wants from me? Why did he put drunk? Why is that here? God wants your full attention. CNN, and I have the link, put an article out, and I've seen several since like it lately. They've done scientific testing. One drop of alcohol has a near irreversible effect on the mind of an individual. I admit, one drop. He's not talking about 40 years of drinking. We know that. But literally, one drop of alcohol changes the chemical outline of the mind. Literally, the gray matter. It can be accelerated. It can be less with some people, more with others. That's how potent it is. That's why in July the 4th weekend, you're going to see buzz driving is, which is a little interesting, isn't it? Because you can get buzzed but not be at the legal limit. And yet that alcohol can still and does still have a dramatic effect on what you do say and how you operate things. It controls you. In this text where he's saying what God wants from his people, he wants individuals first to come to the saving knowledge of Christ. But secondly, he wants communion with you and he wants you to yield to him in compliance. And just as alcohol is controlling with just one drop, the child of God cannot afford to engage in this world in such a way that will ruin their communion with God. That will consider and keep them, I should say, from considering the truths of God's commandments. Our communion with God demands the full use of all our faculties. God wants me to be sanctified. As many believers today, that when it relates to what God wants in life, they cannot give Him their full faculties. Not just drunkenness, but you talk about the addictions. Our minds are everywhere. We could pause right here, folks. We could talk about, I rode for 6 hours with Brother Mark. That's who I'm pointing at yesterday. And I mentioned this to him. I read an article recently, and it talked about Gen Xers, which are today's millennial generation. And it said about them that they find specifically regarding the young men that they are often depressed, higher than any generation that ever before them. They cry out for loneliness more than any generation before them. And they often complain, even among their relationships, of an extreme lack of intimacy, and I'll try to stay above board with it. So those are three chief complaints. It affects their emotional, physical well-being. Their mental health's in high jeopardy. And later in the article, they said, yet they are the busiest generation online. I thought that was quite interesting to me. There's many a fella that's given great years of his life to video gaming, to movies, and God can't have his full attention. God's got to rattle his cage to get his awareness. The child of God ought to be like the silky corn stalks that you see in the field. That they go whichever way the wind of the Holy Spirit of God, the truths of the Word of God, compel them to go. And many an individual, because of their addictions in life, because of how they've argued with God's Word, because of the rebellion that they have fostered in their life, they can't comprehend the full fact of what God wants from them. Yes, God wants them to be saved, but God wants them to be more like Him. Look over in chapter 2. We were there a moment ago. He speaks of it in this wise. Verse number 6, raised us together, made us sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, We're saved by grace in verse number 8. Then he's going to speak later in the passages about how we're made nigh to Christ. But note, if you will, and I'm moving quickly here, I'm just going through highlighted passages of Scripture. He tells them in verse number 4 that they would walk worthy of the vocation wherewith they are called. You know what God wants for you? Every day He wants you to be more holy. Every day He wants you to grow more like Him. He wants you to grow in His knowledge in so much that you think and process information like God thinks and processes information. You say, that's not possible. It is. You have the mind of Christ. My friends, if we could grasp and understand what God has for us, it would dramatically change the outlook we have in life. There's perhaps here some this morning that there's something that has happened to you in the past or hasn't happened to you yet that you really badly want to happen, and that dictates your emotions in life. If you could grasp what God has for you and put all of that in perspective to where you're at in life, it would dramatically change the outlook of your life. There's many Christians that are bitter in life. They're angry. They're frustrated. They're prideful. You pick it, they're there. If you could understand what God wants from you and that He cares for you, that He has a sovereign plan, and part of that sovereign plan is you becoming more like Him in your thought. Your husband, your wife, your children will never be enough. Your children are going to grow up and they are going to disappoint you. Why? You got to meet their parents. They disappointed their parents. It's going to happen. But Jesus Christ is more than enough. He can satisfy your longing. You can find sweet rest in Him. How does that happen? Through the process of sanctification that is the will of God. I must be conformed to Him. We mentioned the Sunday school hour. In order to get the most out of Bible study, I have to have a predisposition of obedience. A lot of times we go in the Scriptures, and if you have any familiarity, there's passages we feel we can just skip because we don't agree with them, or because we want to ignore them. We have gone to the Word of God like it was a buffet table line. And we have picked and choosed around all the things and gathered to ourselves and completely ignored the whole host of God's commandments and precepts. The life of the sanctified believer is a joyful life. It's a thankful life. It's a singing life. It's a submitting life. And you might would say, well, preacher, how do you come to that manifestation? Look at the next verses. Let your eyes catch upon their truths. Verse 19, speaking to yourselves in. God wants you to be singing. Giving thanks. God wants you to be thankful. Look in verse 21. Submitting yourselves. God wants you to be submitting. None of those are possible in the truest sense if not first there is an awakening of your soul unto Christ. And if not second, there is a submission to yourself in the process of sanctification. God must change us. This is the truth. Be not foolishly drunk with wine, where is the baser sort of what you are? Riotous excess. But be filled with the Spirit. Why, there's some that look at the phrase of filling with the Spirit, and they somehow determine that that kind of has a cup that is empty that needs to be full. At the moment of salvation, I got all of the Holy Ghost. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 15, that I was ever going to get. You know what the process of my Christian life is now? Whether or not I'm going to surrender. Whether or not I'm going to yield. Whether or not I'm going to be in compliance to what the Word says. And oh, how often we bring upon ourselves ruination and difficulty and angst. And at the root cause is this. We've decided in life to make decisions that please our flesh. We're like the Proverbs 23. We've realized that every time we followed the flesh, it's ended in abysmal failure. We've realized that we've bursted in anger, and that wasn't the will of God. We realized that various sins that we've committed, that wasn't the will of God for our life, but because we will not let God have His way, we're destined to repeat our sin again and again and again and again. Much like the drunkard. After the choices he's made in life have beaten him and abused him and robbed from him, if he has $2 in his pocket, what's he going to do the next morning? This is a call in our life to comprehend God's working. Oh, might we have a predisposition to the obedience of truth and be wise in it. Let's stand to our feet. Father.
Thank you for listening. If you'd like to contact us, please write us at P.O. Box 126541, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania 17112, and visit our website at www.svbcpa.org. Until next time.